Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Else Deboeuf. I'm a senior advisor for humanitarian affairs here at the International Peace Institute, and I'm pleased to welcome you to this policy forum on attacks against healthcare. IPI is proud to co-host this event with the permanent missions of Egypt, Japan, New Zealand, Spain, and Uruguay, who have recently launched, as many of you know, an initiative to adopt a Security Council resolution on this specific issue. We are pleased to see a large audience, full house, present here and also joining us online, as IPI prides itself to be a place for an open and candid debate on urgent issues on the UN agenda, which I think this one certainly is. When conflict and fighting breaks out, healthcare services are more needed than ever. But it is also when doctors, nurses, paramedics, hospitals, health centers, ambulance, and even patients themselves often become more vulnerable to threats, attacks, looting, detention, and generalized violence. A recent report published by the International Movement of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Healthcare in Danger Project documented almost 2,400 attacks against healthcare services in 11 countries from 2012 to 2014 alone. That is, on average, more than two attacks per day. According to that same report, these attacks caused at least 4,275 casualties, over 1,600 of whom were patients, and nearly 600 healthcare workers in that time in those countries lost their lives. More than half of those attacks took place inside or near a clinic, hospital, or other health facility, many of which were repeatedly attacked and eventually fully destroyed or forced to close. As I said, these numbers reflect the reality in a small number of countries during a short period of time. They are just the tip of an iceberg. Initial data shows that 2015 has been at least as deadly and destructive as previous years, if not more so. Apart from the immediate death and injury and destruction they bring about, such attacks also disrupt and at times bring down entire healthcare systems. In many conflict-ridden countries, the health of entire populations is effectively jeopardized for months and years to come. The spillover effect on the healthcare systems of neighboring countries, which often treat many of the victims and host large refugee populations, is also of increasing alarm. In December 2014, the United Nations General Assembly adopted a resolution recognizing the long-term impact of attacks on healthcare. Last December, the International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent adopted a resolution recommending a range of concrete measures. And today's discussion aims to look into what the UN Security Council and UN member states in general can and should do to put a halt to the current spiral of violence and to ensure better protection of healthcare delivery in situations of conflict. We have a great panel to open that discussion today. You have their full bios in your papers, but just let me briefly introduce them. To my right, Mr. Stéphane Ojeda, Deputy Permanent Observer of the International Committee of the Red Cross to the United Nations and also Legal Advisor of the ICRC New York Delegation. Mr. Jason Cohn, the U.S. Executive Director of Doctors Without Borders, or Médecins Sans Frontières. And to my left, Dr. Nata Menabde, who's the Executive Director of the World Health Organization's office here in New York. We've asked all our panelists to do two things. First, to briefly illustrate the issue from their organization's concrete experience and perspective. And second, to put forth some concrete policy recommendations to prevent and address attacks on healthcare and ensure that victims of conflicts have safe and adequate access to healthcare. We've also asked the representative of the ICRC to briefly recall the main obligations under international humanitarian law that are directly relevant for this discussion. But before turning to the panel, I would like to invite His Excellency Ambassador Roman Oyarzun Marquesi, permanent representative of Spain to the United Nations, to briefly introduce the Security Council initiative on behalf of the group of five penholders of this resolution, namely Egypt, Japan, New Zealand, Spain, and Uruguay. Your Excellency, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Well, first, allow me to thank the IPI for coming up with this initiative. My first request is not to sue IPI because they have gone over the legal capacity. Thank you very much for coming. Impressive attendance. And thank you very much to my dear fellow co-penholders on this initiative. We can see here the DPRs, the ambassadors DPRs of Uruguay, Egypt, New Zealand, and Japan. And thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present this introductory remarks. Well, I'm always under very strong instructions, and my team has told me that I'm supposed to present our draft resolution on attacks against hospitals and medical personnel without actually discussing the content of the resolution. Because negotiations in the Security Council are still ongoing. I'm also supposed to comment on the very unique working methods, a sort of making of perspective of the resolution. And I have been told that I have to do all this in less than 5 minutes. So my apologies in advance. If I leave very crucial points out of my presentation, it is my team's fault. If you want to come up with some questions, the co-pen holders will respond to those questions. And if you have very difficult questions addressed to Spain, they will be addressed to Alejandra del Rio, who is sitting just there. And she is the counselor that has taken care of everything in this event and in the negotiations that are taking place in the Security Council. Why raise this issue in the Security Council? Well, no Security Council member states would agree that the Council's agenda is already overloaded. We need, they say, to choose carefully where we focus our attention. However, attacks against the provision of healthcare are becoming so frequent that humanitarian actors face serious limitations to do their jobs. The wake-up call came from organizations such as Médecins Sans Frontières, who are forced to stay out of certain areas or countries due to the lack of protection on the ground. The panel gathered today is better qualified than I to elaborate on this issue. Given the frequency and intensity of the attacks, we felt compelled to affirm certain principles from the Security Council as a message to the parties in armed conflict. The message is simple. These attacks are unacceptable. We have to stop them. We run the risk of getting used to them when actually our tolerance threshold should be zero. I repeat, zero. Wars may be inevitable, but there are rules to follow. Respecting international humanitarian law is not only a matter of life and death, it is humanity itself that's at stake here. There is a reason why protecting doctors, hospitals, and patients is at the very heart of humanitarian law. With the resolution, we seek to condemn attacks against the provision of healthcare and demand compliance with international humanitarian law, as well as address issues such as humanitarian access, prevention, adequate IHL, training, the facility against impunity, or the need to hold full, prompt, and impartial investigations. We also want to bring attention to this issue in the UN reporting system. Awareness is a key factor to create a safer environment for the humanitarian organizations working on the ground. That is what we want. And then there is what we do not want. We will avoid at all cost the creation of a new international humanitarian law rules. The existing framework, as Stefan will explain, is quite enough. We are not trying to address country-specific situation. The problem is not a single government or a certain armed group or a particular regime. The challenge is precisely that these attacks are increasing in different parts of the world. Most of these ideas, if not all, come from the conversations that we had with civil society, especially the ones sitting on the panel today. Unfortunately, we have had to translate them into something that I never understood, although I've been around in the UN for 12 years. And this is the language of Security Council resolutions that we craft in such a way that we can say this is encrypted English. But it is drafted in a way so we are sure that the resolution meets the concerns of everybody. So, some final remarks on working methods. I believe a resolution presented by five Security Council members is a first. We come, you can see that, from different regions. We are serving different terms in the Council. We have similar but not identical views on substance, and yet we have managed to work together in an exemplary way. Let me underline that we are all equally engaged here, fully committed to the success of this initiative. Those of you who are familiar with the Council dynamics will probably agree with me if I call it a small miracle. So far, we have made it work combining enthusiasm, imagination, and flexibility. The reaction from the rest of the Council has also been remarkable. Our initiative has been discussed in a very constructive spirit, with a good deal of patience, and, well, believe me that drafting among five, it is not an easy job, but we are doing things very, very well. I'm very proud to share with you, my dear colleagues in the Security Council, this initiative. I feel very proud of you. Hopefully, we will be able to share the result with you, because if I say something else, I'm going to get, you know, very soon. We are trying to have the resolution agreed in the coming week and ready for adoption probably early May. And with that, and hoping that I did not exceed my 5 minutes, I thank you very much for being with us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, for this helpful introduction to this proposed resolution. I'd like to now turn to our distinguished panelists before opening the floor for discussion. Mr. Ojeda, you have the floor.
Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you very much, Els. Thank you very much to IPI and to the five mission for co-hosting us. And thanks to all of you for joining us this afternoon. I will divide my brief address into three main parts. The first one will be the theory. I've been asked to discuss a little bit about it. The practice and the final part about recommendations, what can be done. Starting right away, I will stress that the protection of the wounded and sick has been at the heart of IHL from the start. Indeed, the wounded and sick military personnel and the medical personnel taking care of them were the first categories of protected persons under international humanitarian law. It was in the 1864 first Geneva Convention, so adopted 1 year after the creation of the ICRC. And over time, the safeguards of protection and respect were extended to cover all wounded and sick, fighters and civilians, in all types of armed conflict, international and non-international. I will also emphasize that the IHL protection of wounded and sick would be meaningless without its corollary protection of those taking care of the wounded and sick and their supply, their means to do so, the facilities, the transport, etc., etc. So IHL protect both. There's a special protection for both wounded and sick and medical personnel and the means that they need to carry out their work. You will find all these protections, of course, in the four Geneva Conventions of 1949, in the additional protocols of 77 and 2005, and in customary rules of international humanitarian law. I'm focusing here only on IHL, but please note that there are other bodies of law also applying and protecting these aspects in armed conflict situations. I'm thinking about human rights law and medical ethics. So for time-related reasons, I will not be able to go through all the rules of IHL, but let me flag only four of them. All possible measures shall be taken to provide and facilitate essential health care on a non-discriminatory basis to the wounded and sick. The wounded and sick and healthcare personnel, as well as their facilities, transport, etc., shall not be attacked. Access to health facilities, goods, and services shall not be arbitrarily limited, and denials to such access must be avoided as much as possible. And finally, healthcare personnel shall not be punished, shall not be harassed for the simple fact of assisting wounded and sick. That's the most humanitarian act. And if you start questioning this, there's a whole pillar of humanity starting to collapse. So all of these aspects and much more are governed by a wide range of existing rules in various IHL instruments. So indeed, we do not need new rules. What we need is a better implementation of the existing ones. Let me turn now to the second part, the practice. When we look at the implementation of these rules and safeguards in the field, on the ground, and I guess my colleagues will confirm this, the situation is terrible, is alarming. We remain concerned about the widespread and increasing attacks, threats, obstruction, affecting the wounded and sick, healthcare personnel and facilities, and medical transports. And in many cases, it's not involuntary consequences of war. It's deliberate. We're talking about violation of the law. Else, at the beginning, mentioned the study from the ICRC. We started a study in 2008, country studies, to look at the circumstances, the perpetrators, the victims of such violence. And in 3 years, focusing only on 11 countries, so only 11 countries, indeed, we documented almost 2,400 attacks against healthcare personnel, facilities, transport, and patients, more than 2 incidents per day. But what does that mean, concretely speaking? The immediate consequences are quite obvious. Patients are deprived of the care they need, and medical staff are hindered to provide the services. This means higher number of civilian casualties, not only death and injuries, but also disease, disability, etc. And the long-term impact is equally critical, because violence against healthcare providers leads too often to the departure of medical personnel, to the closure of healthcare facilities. And thus, indeed, you have a disruption of entire healthcare systems. And if we break down a little bit more, that means concretely that years of efforts from a particular country or region to fight against certain diseases, to fight against a virus, to improve maternal health, et cetera, all of this is wiped out in a matter of seconds. And it will take years, if not decades, to rebuild all of this. And this is, unfortunately, the reality of today's situation, today's conflict on the ground. So my last part will be, what can we do? As you may know, in 2011, the ICRC launched a project called Healthcare in Danger. So this project has brought to light several areas where the move from commitment to meaningful action needs to be made a priority by all those concerned. So let me flag only 3 of these areas. First one is strengthening domestic legislation. Because we keep saying, okay, we don't need new rules, we need to implement the existing rules. Okay, but that means that all the international legal rules that we already have, if we want to translate them, to implement them, it starts as well with the domestic legislation. We should focus our effort on domestic legislation. We should also focus on incorporating these rules protecting healthcare personnel into the practice, the operational practice of armed forces, training, doctrine, etc. And we must also talk, even if people do not like that, but we must also talk to the other side, to the other parties in an armed conflict, meaning the non-state armed groups. They must also be made aware of the rules, and we have developed, in the frame of this healthcare in danger, a model of unilateral declaration that armed groups can sign and rely on to declare their intention to respect the healthcare. Most recently, states have reiterated their support to the healthcare in danger project through the adoption of a resolution during the International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent in December 2015 in Geneva. And on the basis of this, there are certain pledges, quite interesting, which have been taken. We welcome as well the fact that the issues of attacks against healthcare is underscored in the Secretary General report to the World Humanitarian Summit. And of course, we also welcome very much the current Security Council work on a resolution, because indeed the Council members, both individually and collectively, have a recognized and expected role in promoting and ensuring respect for the principles and rules of IHL. So reaffirming the relevance of the laws of war and demanding their respect is the most decisive answer that the Council can give to this global concern. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. May I now turn to Mr. Jason Cohn from MSF?
Thank you, and I wanted to first thank the ambassadors from New Zealand, Spain, Uruguay, Japan, and Egypt for their leadership on this important issue, initiating the Security Council discussions. It's a critical moment to reaffirm the protection of the wounded and the sick, and the protections of medical facilities, personnel, equipment, and transports in armed conflict. And I'd like to thank IPI for hosting this event. This discussion comes at a time where patients and healthcare workers have come under fire across a wide range of conflict zones. During the month of October 2015 alone, an MSF trauma center in Kunduz, Afghanistan was bombed, killing 42 staff and patients. 12 hospitals in Syria, including 6 supported by MSF, were attacked. And an MSF health center in Hayden, Yemen was destroyed. In Syria, MSF-supported facilities were hit 94 times by bombing or shelling in 2015 alone. We're outraged at the string of attacks on hospitals and the resulting loss of life of healthcare workers, patients, and caretakers. The continued targeting of medical personnel, patients, and facilities constitutes a grave breach of international humanitarian law. While these recent aerial attacks have been the most visible expression of the assault on medical care in conflict, MSF staff, like their national healthcare worker colleagues, have been kidnapped, assaulted, threatened, and harassed. MSF hospitals have been robbed and ransacked, and equipment looted or destroyed in many conflicts around the world today. Most of these incidents have a direct and indirect consequences on MSF's operational capacities and choices, and most importantly, our ability to access and treat patients. When health services stop functioning as a result of attacks, people are deprived of life-saving medical care, making life even more unbearable in conflict-stricken areas. This situation is unacceptable. Some patients are often too scared to come to hospitals. Others are unable to reach hospitals even when they try. In the most extreme cases, patients are killed in their beds. In South Sudan, 58 people were killed on hospital grounds between December 2013 and June 2015, including 25 patients killed in MSF hospital compounds in Bentiu, Bor, Lir, and Malakal. Last month, the MSF hospital in Pibor in southern Jonglei State was ransacked after fighting broke out in the surrounding area. The resulting withdrawal of MSF health services and personnel meant local populations could not access medical care when they need it most, adding to their suffering and leading, we believe, to many deaths that might have been avoided. MSF medical staff have been threatened or harassed by combatants in the Democratic Republic of Congo, Central African Republic, Lebanon, Honduras, and Myanmar, just to name a few. In many of these places, comrades, armed combatants are demanding that their comrades be treated first, or denying care to patients based on ethnic, religious, or political grounds. These abuses violate the fundamental principle of impartial medical care, the triage of patients solely based on their health needs. In short, It is a critical moment for member states to strongly reaffirm the sanctity of the Medical Act in armed conflict. In this context, MSF calls to member states fall into three broad categories: respect of patients, reaffirmation of the protected nature of the medical mission, and lastly, accountability. In terms of respect for patients, the prerogatives of people to seek and receive the care they need in conflict situations when they're sick or wounded should be reaffirmed by all parties to the conflict. We ask of all warring parties, both state and non-state actors alike, to respect all patients' need to seek and receive care in conflict-stricken areas. Secondly, the reaffirmation of the protected nature of the medical mission is absolutely essential. In any given conflict, functioning hospitals and medical personnel should always be protected. This is a particularly acute issue in some contemporary contexts, where we observe states pushing national counterterrorism laws or domestic laws which contradict and often overrule IHL provisions on the protection of the medical mission. We need to see public reaffirmations that functioning health facilities should never be a target. State and non-state actors must publicly and unambiguously recommit and restate their respect for the protection of impartial healthcare in conflict, and support obligations of healthcare workers to treat all sick and wounded without discrimination or interference, including wounded combatants and those even designated as enemies or terrorists. We cannot accept any criminalization of the Medical Act. Any resolution should reinforce and strengthen protection for medical ethics. We cannot see the arrest of doctors for conducting their duties for the wounded and sick. We cannot have hospitals turned into places where the enemy is captured. In our experience, abuses of the protected status of medical facilities and personnel leads to patients not seeking health care and increases the toll of the armed conflicts we see today. Lastly, on the accountability for attacks. When an incident occurs, it should neither be the responsibility of the victims nor the perpetrators to establish and qualify the facts. As of today, suspected perpetrators get away with self-investigating, and there is no independent follow-up of attacks. While MSF is not seeking justice, we do seek accountability, and the assignment of responsibility is a way to build political pressure and contribute toward preventing further attacks is essential. Practically, we ask for clarity on the facts, the circumstances, and intentions that explain an incident or attack. In order to take appropriate measures and secure commitments towards preventing further attacks, so as to allow MSF and other healthcare workers to continue providing care to populations in conflict. Whenever an attack occurs, an impartial and independent fact-finding mechanism should establish the facts. States should commit to upholding these standards of independence when it comes to fact-finding efforts. In addition to an independent fact-finding mechanism, we seek regular reporting to increase visibility on the issues, as outlined by my colleague from ICRC. It's important that these discussions continue in key fora. Today is only the beginning of the conversation. It needs to continue. This is not about supporting the establishment of a database in and of itself, but about creating a mechanism which regularly forces high-level discussions on and gives visibility to this issue in multilateral platforms. There should be a regular and formal reporting of attacks against healthcare at the highest levels. Incidents and attacks against medical facilities and personnel should be reported regularly by the UN Secretary General and other relevant fora, such as the World Health Organization. The Security Council has a critical opportunity to take a first and important step in reaffirming the rules of war that recognize the protected status of healthcare workers, the sick and the wounded. We ask that the Council seize this moment to unambiguously recommit to upholding the norms that govern the conduct of war and maintain a space for humanity at the heart of hostilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jason. May I now turn to Dr. Menabding from WHO?
Thank you. I'd like to indeed thank all of the participants of this gathering to join us here today, but also for the organizers to put this event together and to actually further heighten the level of discussion which is currently happening around many fora. And I think it's indeed a very important issue. During emergencies, the delivery of healthcare services is vital not just for the immediate survival of the populations affected, but also it is repeatedly identified by the affected populations as the most important need in terms of humanitarian assistance. And that's the view of the populations themselves. Addressing health needs during emergencies, again, not just saves lives, but it also affects longer-term health outcome of those nations. And ladies and gentlemen, this is also increasingly has become an issue of global health security. And I think we need to see this not just as something which is happening locally, but that it is really engaging and getting into the scale where global health security is affected. Addressing health needs in those situations is really a very challenging job. And attacks on the healthcare settings is the most challenging intervention that needs to be responded. It's really challenging. In 2015, we have unprecedented amount of people affected by all kinds of emergencies. It was in above 125 million of the populations that have been affected. This is unprecedented, and this is growing, and it's increasingly becoming a great challenge. Now, I'd like to mention a couple of other context-related issues. So these attacks are happening in the situation where demands are already very high, where services are very difficult to deliver, where supplies, medical supplies, medicines, other emergency supplies are not available readily. There is an ongoing conflict, so there is an increased anxiety of the population, but also of health workers themselves and their families and the families of the patients and the whole communities. And it's stress and exhaustion, and all this is topped out by those attacks. So we need to see the whole big picture when we are talking about the consequences. And the bad side of it is that sometimes these are targeted attacks, sometimes they are indiscriminate attacks, and victims of attacks are sometimes threatened only, but that again is equally affecting the level of provision of health services. So even if the attack doesn't happen, but the threat is there, health personnel is heavily affected by that. So I just want to echo again what colleagues from MSF have mentioned. Indeed, patients are shut in their beds, and hospitals and healthcare facilities are looted. And that, again, is sometimes part of the warfare tactics. So it's not happening necessarily by chance. It is part of the tactics. So there are many ways where we can intervene to perhaps change this situation. So WHO is, of course, very much concerned with all this happening. And we need to bring this issue to the attention, not only to the international, but indeed also to the national contexts. And we need to actually know more about some of those numbers that have been mentioned here, because many of those attacks still remain undocumented, and we don't know exactly what are the numbers, what are the reasons, why this happens, to what scale it happens, etc. So we do not even have at the moment standardized definitions and classifications for data collection to better understand the problem and find solutions. So this is something we as WHO think must be a focus of the international community in the years to come. And we need to not just apply the good practices, but we need to indeed ensure that those attacks are prevented and our health colleagues, and we are losing many of them, are protected. Even during the, just to add a couple of words to some of the examples which were illustrating the severity of the situation, we have been facing such attacks during Ebola outbreak in West Africa. We have seen polio vaccinators killed in Nigeria, in Pakistan. So this is happening on a daily life. So WHO is committed to improve the standardization of data collection on attacks on health care in emergencies, and particularly to better understand consequences of those attacks in longer term. We need common definitions, we need to compare the data, and we need to ensure that the collection system talk to each other, so interoperability is indeed very important. We need to demonstrate multiple effect of those attacks, first on the workers and facilities, but also on the communities, on the long-term health outcomes, global public health, and attainment of SDG ultimately. So it's all very connected. WHO, of course, will continue to advocate with all the stakeholders to reduce the likelihood of attacks, and we also promote applying some good practices within the health cluster partners, but also other stakeholders to reduce those effects. At the World Humanitarian Summit, we will be looking for commitments that are powerful, concrete, and actionable. It is very clear that the seriousness of issue is not given proper significance. So far, all the outrage which has been voiced in many fora and in many occasions, they still failed to generate the necessary action. And the issue is at heart of the World Humanitarian Summit. We need to ensure upholding of decency, dignity, humanism, and morality. And it's our hope that with improved information, we'll be able to better understand the issue and then to be better able to respond to it and to work on this with all the organizations and institutions and parties to the conflict also and affected communities to ensure that healthcare is provided in emergency setting in a safe way and those who need this safety more are not affected by violence and obstruction. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have extremely disciplined speakers today. They stick exactly to the time that they were given, which is great because that allows also for sufficient time for questions and comments and suggestions. I want to thank the panelists for these very enlightening perspectives and the helpful proposals. But I'd like to now turn to the audience to put questions, comments, suggestions to the panelists, to the member states in general. For the people in the room, if you could please raise your hand if you would like to take the floor briefly. Somebody will come back with a mic. Maybe you want to keep your hand up if you haven't had the chance. And briefly just say who you are and what government or organization you represent. For those of you who are joining us online, you're welcome to tweet in your questions and make sure to use the IPINST hashtag. Thank you. So I'll maybe now take questions like two or three together before giving the floor to the panelists. Sir?
Thank you. William Verdone, Chairman of African Views Organization. Mr. Cohn, you mentioned something really very enlightening in that you treat both the enemy to make them well and to make them whole. This might be a naive question, but when they're well, where do they go? Are there authorities to arrest them, or do they go back to their countries and presumably and hopefully not continue fighting? Thank you.
Thank you. The lady, I think maybe I'll take the three in a row there.
Hi, I'm Susanna Serkin with Physicians for Human Rights. My question is about justice, and following Jason Cohn's explanation about MSF's understandable position on accountability, but maybe not the justice arena, human rights organizations and many others involved in holding parties accountable under international humanitarian law clearly understand that in many cases, the attacks that we've discussed here do constitute war crimes, crimes against humanity, and even elements of the crime of genocide. And so my question to you, any of you on the panel and to others, is to what extent are we currently satisfied with the both national, regional, and international justice regime to hold governments and other parties accountable for these kinds of crimes? And to what degree do you think the resolution will deal with not only accountability, but also justice?
Okay, thank you very much for that. That was a clear question.
Good afternoon, I'm Leonard Rubenstein. I'm chair of the Safeguarding Health and Conflict Coalition, which is a consortium of about 30 or 35 NGOs that provide healthcare in conflict or are concerned as human rights organizations about protection. I want to pick up Jason Cohn's point about criminalization because it gets to the heart of the Security Council resolution. There's a tendency at the United Nations to defer to national law. And unfortunately, in many countries, the provision of healthcare to a person who is deemed an enemy is a crime. And unless the provisions of international humanitarian law and international human rights law prevail, and the Security Council requires that those prevail over the attempted criminalization of health care under domestic law, we won't have made any progress. And it'll just be a feel-good event saying, we affirm that health care should be protectors, that health workers should be protected. But unless that question is addressed head-on and that international law prevails over attempts to criminalize impartial health care, we won't have achieved anything. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll maybe take one more, and then I'll give the panelists a chance to respond.
Thank you. My name is Dr. Annie Sparrow. I work in Syria, training doctors and reporting on human rights violations. So I have two questions really directed with regards to respect, reaffirmation. Geneva Conventions are predicated on rational players. And we see in Syria a total war strategy where the rules of war are deliberately broken. Now we see that not only in the targeting of doctors, the detention, incarceration, but like yesterday, the tracking down and assassination of key players, of key doctors, such as Dr. Hassan, who led the whole health services in Hama. So we are seeing a very, very specific targeting. The number one cause of death for aid workers used to be road traffic accidents. And now it is death either due to this global shortage of humanitarian space or because of direct targeting. And that's a very serious issue because, of course, it means less people want to go and be humanitarians. And then we, allied to that, unfortunately, we see this domestic and international discrimination where, for example, when Dr. Abbas Khan was arrested, detained, incarcerated from Britain in Syria a couple of years ago, a great deal of attention was paid to that, while hundreds of doctors at that time were already incarcerated, detained, tortured, and several hundred had already been killed. So we do see that. And then the part which Len Rubinstein was referring, the criminalization, I believe it goes beyond that. While we are seeing these attacks predominantly, for example, airstrikes, of course, from the ground, from the airs, on the ground, we are seeing the criminalization of doctors being made into terrorists, painted deliberately as terrorists, such as happens in Syria. And that has effect on donors, and aid becomes conditional on who controls the ground that you are working on. And this is a very serious issue, and it's certainly been happening in Syria now for 2 years. And I think it's that flip side of humanitarian neutrality where we mustn't forget what is literally happening on the ground because there is impact on donors and agencies as well. And then finally, when we see the effects, after 5 years in Syria, the lifespan has dropped from 71 years to 55. That's lower than Afghanistan, that's lower than Rwanda, that's lower than Libya, that's where the US was 100 years ago. So we can see very clearly, after only 5 years, how serious this is. I'm sorry, in terms of a question, I'd very much like to know how this could be enforced or implemented. And thank you, WHO, for taking on health attacks, finally. I'm very happy to see a return to fundamental human rights.
Thank you very much. I'll now leave the panelists, I'll leave it up to you who wants to respond to what questions before I'll take another round of questions. Thank you.
So just on the question of where do the quote-unquote enemies go after they're treated well, it's little concern to us. Our job is to bring them back whole once they're wounded or they're sick. They're off the battlefield and they should be treated as such. And that's the main point of, and it relates to what Dr. Rubinstein is saying in terms of we must push back on in all efforts to criminalize that medical act. It can't be something that is forced upon medical practitioners, whether they be local, international, wherever they may be. And I think it's at the core, as Stefan was saying, it's at the core of the protections in the international humanitarian law that we have today and must be protected and must be a benchmark, I think, for the success of any resolution of the Council puts forward and enacts. In terms of the accountability question, certainly we're not satisfied with the state of affairs that we have today. I think for us, at the bare minimum, we can't have doctors being seen as having to investigate the crimes committed against them, and we certainly can't have the perpetrators being the judges. And so at the end of the day, I think we need to fundamentally address that status quo that exists today and confront it head on, for sure. And I think the last thing I would say is that it must be very clear that it is the national health workers at the national level that are bearing the brunt of the atrocities that we see. They are the ones dying in greater numbers. Certainly international aid workers, including doctors and nurses and other healthcare workers, are facing grave dangers, but nonetheless, they can leave. They actually have the active choice of leaving, whereas we've seen that's not the case in too many conflict zones today. So it's and with all the health implications that that Annie has acknowledged occurs. I'll stop there and let others intervene.
Well, thank you very much for the different questions. I will not repeat what Jason have already answered. I fully agree with. I will focus only on two aspects, maybe the criminalization of the medical act. Yes, indeed, we see that it's happening more and more. We see also that it's happening through the development of the global counterterrorism framework, which maybe does not take enough into consideration IHL rules protecting the healthcare. So our role is also to remind all involved stakeholders about these rules, and that to provide healthcare to whoever and whatever the person is defined, terrorist or not, is not a material support to terrorism. It's the medical act, the medical care. And this act in 1864, when I mentioned the first categories of persons protected by IHL, and throughout the development of the laws of war, all stakeholders, states in particular, agreed with the ICRC when we said the medical act and the medical personnel should be placed above the war. They should be kept above all of the tensions, the conflicts, the violence, etc. It's separate. We should respect this. And maybe we are seeing more and more that we are forgetting about this need to place medical act, medical care, and medical personnel above the war. So we should aim at re-seeing this. I think I'll stop there.
Yeah. Dr. Menabde.
Let me mention that the norms that govern health service delivery during emergencies are the rights to life, rights to dignity, equal rights to all persons, rights to medical care. These are all included in the Declaration on Human Rights. Of course, there are Geneva Convention and protocols, but there are also principles of neutrality, impartiality, independence, humanity, which are principles of humanitarian action. And also, the health personnel is actually bound to duty of care and medical ethics. But all these norms, unfortunately, are very elusive when it comes to the real life situation in the emergencies. And accountability is absolutely critical. Unless there is some action to hold parties accountable, it will not stop, it will grow. So what we suggest now is to look at the numbers carefully and have a good methodology to assess, document, compare those data so that accountability can be actually exercised. But of course, it's a justice issue, and it has to be, I mean, WHO is not the institution which can answer the question how it can be done, but at least something has to be done because too many norms are violated and it just goes like that and acted upon. Especially also because of tracing down and picking some particularly good doctors and, you know, those who are the best organized and most committed, they are targeted, as I said, because it's a part of war tactics. So that needs to be addressed beyond the occasional, by chance, accidents when health workers die. So we need to really put this issue really on the surface and make it a prominent issue, and therefore the initiative of Security Council discussion is critical, very important, and we are standing in full support to any strong measures that can be coming out of this initiative.
Thank you. Okay, I see more hands. Maybe here in the front row, and then the gentleman in the back. Somebody's coming.
Yes, hi, good afternoon. My name is Eva Smets. I'm the director for Watchlist on Children and Armed Conflict. My question is specifically about, as Mr. Cohen expressed, concerns for accountability. And I also heard, you know, some words about the WHO on working definitions to better monitor this. I just wanted to recall that the Council does have a Security Council resolution that references attacks on hospitals. It was adopted in 2011, and operational article number 3 as a definition mandates the UN monitoring and reporting mechanism to monitor and report on recurrent attacks on schools and or hospitals and recurrent attacks or threats of attacks against protected persons in relation to schools and or hospitals in situations of armed conflict. As a result of this documentation, the Secretary General is able to list parties to conflict on an annual basis. As we're speaking, the Office of the SRSG on Children and Armed Conflict is in the process of composing its annual report, which will include an updated list of perpetrators of these grave violations. Up till now, no party to conflict has ever been listed specifically for attacks on hospitals. With some of the numbers that I've heard here from the esteemed members of the panel, Mr. Cohen from MSF Experiences, Dr. Menabde from the WHO, don't we have sufficient documentation to list some parties to conflict for this particular violation in the upcoming report?
Thank you for that.
I'm Dr. Daniele of the International Organization of Victims Assistance, and would like to point out that we are talking about caretakers as victims right now. I want to share frustration with the room, which I'm sure is shared by many. In 2002, we published a book for the UN called Sharing the Front Lines and the Back Hills, which covered all actors during crises, which very systematically and methodically, with the collaboration of all my colleagues here too, revealed the impact on caregivers and the cost incurred on them in all crises, under all circumstances. It had some impact, but again and again and again, every year or two, we again wave the outraged sense of pain at the demoralization, really, of how low we have got. Nobody's above it. Clergy is not above it. Teachers are not above it, doctors are not above it, humanitarians are not above it. I think we have to accept that as maybe the beginning of the new resolutions. And I want just to make one recommendation, if I may, to treat it from before, during, and after, because from the comments, you're talking about during and somewhat after, about the for example, the justice implications. I would like to also add the traumatogenic aspect, the preparedness for the workers and anybody who goes to wartime. Before, protection during, and healing and help for integration after. You did, Dr. Menabe, you pointed out that it is multidimensional. Everybody gets traumatized. True. So everybody needs healing. And not just 1 week and leave, but ongoing. So I'd like the resolution to reflect that it's a long-term commitment. These are not just, random happenings, both in space and in time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I believe we have a gentleman there.
Thank you, Jeff Laurenti. First of all, you all have been doing God's work. And sometimes God's work does not get high priority in the highest political councils. I wonder if you might tell us to what extent the International Criminal Court's jurisdiction would, in your view, extend to recurrent cases of attacks on healthcare facilities. Isn't that not self-enforcing, at least in those areas where a subscribing state has already become part of the court's jurisdiction? And this probably goes much more to Ambassador Oyarzun Marchesi and his colleagues here. To what extent in the discussions within the council has the question of an independent monitoring mechanism or oversight body been a deal breaker in discussions? What are the ways in which we go beyond an occasional ritual expression of sorrow, but moving to actual measures of accountability would appear to be always pretty difficult and always politically calculated case by case as to what's in the interests of the five and maybe a few of the elected 10.
Thank you for that. I'll maybe go back to the panel. I don't know if in what order you want to.
Okay.
Yeah. Mr. Ojeda.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the comments and the various questions. I will react to three aspects, maybe. Each year to wave outrage, etc. Yes, but we should not underestimate this. It's great that outrage is expressed again and again. And we should not underestimate the power and the weight of reaffirming the relevance of the laws. Because it's a danger to say that, okay, the laws are designed only for rational people, but there are so many violations that, well, you know, the laws do not matter anymore. No, no. It just means that there are gazillions of violations, but that does not mean that the law is not relevant anymore. My second point is about the violations against healthcare personnel and healthcare facilities. Yeah, they are serious violations, and they may amount to war crimes, and they are already in the statutes of the International Criminal Court, so they could be, in theory, prosecuted. And to the last question about the independent monitoring mechanism, of course, I would let you answer. I would just like to flag that under international humanitarian law, such independent mechanism already exists. If you look at Article 90 of Additional Protocol 1 of 1977, there's the establishment of an independent humanitarian fact-finding commission who could be used to establish the facts and to have an objective, independent analysis of what happened. The problem is that it has never been used.
Thank you. Jason, do you want to also?
Yeah, I mean, I think very strong comments. I think at the end of the day, it's the choice of states whether or not to list countries. The mechanisms are there to do so. It's ultimately that is a political choice. It's a choice, and there are systems, as Stefan has noted. We have the fact-finding commission. It has not ever been allowed to do any work. It's it's essentially a consensual mechanism. So I think it's just important to remind that it's not for those panelists up here today, but it is effectively the responsibility of states to enact the provisions that they've signed on to and the systems in which they've created and enacted. And also just to the point of dealing with and which was a bit made earlier on the notion of dealing with so-called rational actors. Look, doctors in conflict, nurses in conflict, all the different healthcare workers, they have to work in incredibly difficult situations, and they have to negotiate and navigate a very difficult space across front lines. That requires dealing with people that we would, normal human beings, would call irrational. It assumes that we consider the act of killing people a rational act, but we're not naive. War is here. That's why those laws exist, to give some measure of humanity, but it also requires that those who decide to go into conflicts and those who are forced to stay and care for the sick and the wounded, that space is recognized and affirmed and protected because it is an important act. Whether or not it is in, as we see today, most conflicts are so-called internal conflicts or civil wars, it requires that there is going to be humanitarian access in areas that are controlled by the enemy, and that these spaces need to be recognized, be it hospitals, be it other places, ambulances, as safe places where those can get the care they need, regardless of what side they may be trapped on, because that being on that side does not mean an actual affiliation necessarily with the politics or the reasons that those conflicts are unfolding. So,
okay, thank you, Jason. Ambassador, do you want to react now or do you want to react a bit later to that question that was addressed?
Who wants to react also?
Or we can, or towards the end, as you wish. Okay, all right. Okay, so. Is there any other questions?
No.
Just a second. Just want to give everybody a chance. I'll come back. There's one person there in the back.
Good afternoon. Maureen Quinn, International Peace Institute. I would just like to ask the panelists if they could comment a little bit more about some of the practical things that you have said. You talked about data collection, the importance of that, training of all forces. And so what is being done already, what might more be done in those two areas? Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen.
Linda Rollins, I'm a journalist with IPS Interpress Service. Understanding that we're talking about very many perpetrators, including both state and non-state actors, but we're also talking about the role of the Security Council. I did want to ask, when we're talking about the role of the members of the Security Council, in some cases, they are, in fact, perpetrators of these acts or supplying weapons to perpetrators of these acts. So if maybe going a little bit beyond the current resolution that's being considered, if anybody would be willing to provide comments on that. Thank you.
Thank you. I see Dr. Sparrow has another question and promised to be short, so sure.
Comes to the question of when international law is translated into domestic legislation, and we know that countries can then still criminalize, for example, the act of treating, what then is the role of customary law? Because shouldn't that then override domestic criminalization because customary law still dictates the right to protect civilians, and that is recognized even if a country hasn't ratified it? So that's my question.
Thank you. One more.
Thanks so much. Michelle Brown with Action Against Hunger. And we've launched a campaign on the protection of aid workers more broadly and have floated the idea of appointing a special mandate holder on the protection of humanitarian personnel to be the focal point within the UN system to address some of the more concrete measures that have been raised today. So I would be curious to hear what others have to say about the idea. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'll maybe now turn to our panelist, Dr. Menamd.
WHO is finalizing its tool, which has been under development for some time, on the data collection, and it proved to be a very complex and complicated exercise. This month it will be finalized. Then we have to see whether it's applicable and in what settings it's applicable. In fact, that tool looks not just at the conflict situations, but also at broader range of all kinds of emergencies where we need numbers. But of course, because of such a complex task, the tool is a little too complex, it's resource intensive, and one has to see whether applying this tool is not going to be, it's going to be outweighed with the benefits it brings. So we need to really assess that practically. However, as someone, a colleague here in the first row said, we already do have some numbers, okay? We may not have scientifically all the proven and interoperable data, but we know this is happening. So there's no reason why we should not be acting upon that even before we have a perfect data. And that's, I think, what is hopefully gonna happen. So I think that's the immediate response to where we are within WHO on this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for these questions. Regarding the practical measures, the details, I will invite you to look at the website healthcareindanger.org, where you will have all the recommendations. And it ranges from very sophisticated to really practical. So it can be help from advisory services from the ICRC to help states to devise their own domestic legislation in accordance with international obligations. And it can go to really practical, like for hospitals, you would like to have plastic sheet on the window so if there's an attack, it does not explode, this kind of thing. So it goes from sophisticated to very practical. When it comes to violations by member states to the UN, well, I will just recall Common Article 1 of the four Geneva Conventions saying that all states must respect and ensure respect. So indeed, if some states are not directly involved, they still have the obligation to talk to the ones involved and to convince them to respect their obligations under IHL. With regard to customary law and domestic legislation, it's not that customary law can supersede domestic legislation. It's just that domestic legislation should reflect what the international obligations are, and the international obligations stem from both treaty and customary laws. So yes, you can use customary law to strengthen, to back up your point that a certain domestic legislation is in contradiction with these international rules.
Thank you. Jason, do you want to add on to some of those comments?
I think the point about having an appointee of a special mandate, I think that can be interesting in terms of the sense of giving some visibility, but we have to, I think, keep in mind the broader scope. I mean, there are many of these positions that exist today across a wide spectrum of issues, and is that sort of what's needed at this point in time? I think that's up for debate. Don't have necessarily a specific stance on that per se. Just to say that I think what we're talking about today is a very important first step. Right, it is a reaffirmation of existing laws, conventions, treaty obligations, customary law, and it's a very important one. We see good leadership here, Representative Tate, to try and push that forward at the council level. But I think it is incredibly important that we don't stop here in New York. This obviously has to play out both in the field, but it also has to happen at both a regional and national level. There are many regional bodies for which this can be looked at and addressed. We see the way things are playing out tends to be different depending on conflicts. There, you know, the examples we gave today in many ways are some conflicts that are quite visible, but the breaches of sort of the protections of medical facilities and the harassment of both patients and personnel plays out in many different ways in different conflicts. It's not uniform in that sense. And so that requires both a regional and national dialogue and ensuring, as we said at the outset, that those domestic laws don't undermine or criminalize the medical act or the protections that should be afforded to the sick and the wounded.
Okay, thank you. I think we have time for one more question if somebody still has a burning question. Otherwise, I'll ask the panelists maybe to share a final thought if they want to. Okay, good. So maybe I'll just give you an opportunity if there's a final thought or recommendation you still want to share with us today, and then I'll come back to the States as well. Dr. Menamde, do you want to add anything or make a final call?
I think there is a necessity to continue high-level advocacy at political level, at national level, at international level, and we all have to step up that effort because, of course, data and some other tools are necessary, but we need to keep this high on all agendas. And as the ambassador has mentioned in the beginning, tolerance should be zero, and I think this is a very ambitious statement, and that's what makes this work different from all the previous Security Council resolutions and the other resolutions of the General Assembly, where it was not strong enough, perhaps, and now it's coming to no tolerance and coming to zero. And I think that's an opportunity where we really have to make it happen. So thank you.
Thank you. Jason, do you want to make a final comment?
So I think what we're, sadly, we're here today because we've reached such a critical moment where the most fundamental sort of protections that civilians should be afforded are really threatened. And the last line of defense we have for humanity in terms of keeping people safe in a hospital is continually threatened day in, day out across a wide spectrum of conflicts as we know today. So I think it's important to remind that this is a critical step push back against that trajectory, but it is not in any way an acceptable situation that we can treat our patients and then as soon as they walk out the door, they're slaughtered. And I can't just reaffirm that enough, that this is the beginning of really protecting the very foundational aspects of the law and sort of the things that bind us as a community, as a society, and as humanity. But it is a battle that we are fighting and is the last line of defense in that battle. And so if we cannot reaffirm these things today in these bodies and in these places, we are taking a huge step back in just the general protection of civilians at large, let alone those who will care for the sick and the wounded.
Listen, Stefan, do you want to make a final comment?
Yes, I would like to thank everybody in the room. I would call, as a last point, I would call for better compliance with international humanitarian law. I would call for an implementation of the healthcare in danger practical recommendations, for a sharing of good practices between states. I hope that the resolution will be adopted by consensus at the United Nations Security Council, that would send a strong signal. And my last word is I hope that we will see soon a diminution towards an end of violence against healthcare. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all the panelists. I think you will all agree with me that this was a rich discussion, illustrating also the very real and dire impact that attacks on healthcare have on people around the world. I definitely hope that this debate also will prove useful in the preparation for the upcoming discussions on this important topic in the Security Council in the coming weeks. And I'm looking now in particular to the representatives of the five pen holders of the resolution. If perhaps one of you would like to share also some final thoughts on behalf of the group. I believe Caroline Schwalger, the DPR for the New Zealand Permanent Missions to the UN. And I believe our Egyptian colleague also would like to speak up. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to frame my comments as a series of thank yous, but also I hope I can address some of the comments that were here today. And Osama and other colleagues may wish to compliment or add to what I have to say. So first of all, can I thank IPI? I know we've thanked you, but clearly you have a pulling power and you've given a platform to something that we think is very important. I think the attendance here today, the contributions, the comments, the outrage that we've heard show that we were not alone as a group of five with ICRC and MSF and WHO and having very serious concerns about this issue. And as our colleague has said, that we've reached a critical point where we need to turn back the tide. So I think attendance and the interest here today also vindicates our sense that there was a need for the Security Council to have a voice. And it was a voice which not only condemns, I guess, what we're seeing and the challenge that the actions we're seeing is posing to the core tenets of international humanitarian law. We also thought it was important the Security Council has a voice in demanding the implementation of existing international humanitarian law, which is something all our panelists have echoed here today. And also we wanted to take the chance to encourage parties to the conflict and member states to take practical steps to do what they can to turn back the tide. I don't think I could possibly address all the questions that have been raised or comments that have been made, but let me try and at least do a couple so you know what we're thinking about in terms of the resolution. An early comment was made pointing out about the existing resolutions that we have that speak to this matter, and I want to assure you that we've reflected in the resolution and drawn on and recalled all of those relevant resolutions, so that's there. On the question of non-punishment, I just want to let you know it's certainly an issue that we want to have covered in the resolution. It's still one of the issues under negotiation, if I'm perfectly frank, but you can be assured that this group recognises the importance of this issue, and we'll be doing our best on that front. On the question of reporting that was raised by a watch list, thank you for the points that you've made. We certainly have looked at the CAC framework in terms of what it can provide. We've looked at it from the outset. We've talked with UNICEF. And we're really working as a group to, in the CAC context at least, to, you know, improve the language, especially on hospitals or the so-called medical mission in that working group. But we're interested to keep talking. And I know at least as New Zealand, we've been in touch on this issue. My second lot of thank you beyond IPI and the discussion you've generated here today is to thank the stakeholders. I think even though it's kind of interesting and unique that we've worked together as a group of five, the early, active, substantive and encouraging participation that you've had in this process with us as a group, I think isn't something we necessarily always see in the development of Security Council resolutions. So you outreached to you, we outreached back, and I think we can be sure that we'll have a better product as a result of this collaboration. And to the wider stakeholders here today, be assured that we've heard your voices, and we're very much trying to reflect the, you know, wider interests that we have heard from people, and we'll take on specific suggestions. We've been trying to take on specific suggestions where we can. And in this front, I also, I don't know how many are here, but to fellow Security Council members, we'd also like to thank them. They have been incredibly constructive in this exercise, I have to say. They've given us contributions in the same way that stakeholders have, which have certainly strengthened the resolution. And as I said, many points have been raised here today. One of the challenges that we have as a group of five is to keep a clarity of the message in this resolution. We could put many, many relevant and related components into this resolution, but as our colleague from NSF said, the key thing here is to have a platform, a first step on turning back the trend, turning back the tide. So we'll have a job. We won't meet everybody's wishes in this resolution, I can be sure of that, but do know that we're listening and trying our best. Another quick thank you is to my fellow group of five, and that's also, I think, important, as Ambassador says. I think we brought different views. We were able to outreach to different regions and different interest groups as a result of being an eclectic mix of five council members. But I also think it's increased the chances of a consensus resolution out of the council and a united voice from the council on this issue. So I wanted to thank colleagues for that. And finally, my last group of thank yous is to the wider General Assembly membership. We really need your support in this exercise. It is our intention, if we're successful in this exercise, to hold an open briefing, and it's on our minds to open it to co-sponsorship. So we would like to ask the countries that are here today not only to consider looking at it with a serious eye to co-sponsorship, but bringing along all your groups, your networks, and your constituency, fellow member states, to make sure this resolution has a high level of co-sponsorship to send a universal message that the trends we're seeing, the actions we're seeing are unacceptable, and that we as United Nations and group of member states reject what we're seeing. So I'll pass to Osama.
Thank you, Ambassador.
Thank you very much. I add my voice to Ambassador Ayerthorn and to my dear colleague Caroline in thanking the IPI for taking the initiative to invite us to that very important briefing, extremely beneficial to us as diplomats. And I'd just like to shed in a few seconds why Egypt did decide to co-sponsor that initiative and so on. We found it very pertinent, very relevant to the region where I come from. We're the Arab member in the council and one of the African members in the council. It's a step on the right direction. It's really about raising awareness and a step on the right direction for advocacy and so on. Caroline was kind enough to cover a lot of the the technical details and so on. My recollection, I have read the draft several times. First of all, of course, few of us took the liberty to discuss it with the CSOs, and we felt that we were obliged to do so because truly most of those CSOs are doing a wonderful job on the ground. I saw Fabienne from Médecins Sans Frontières and Azad and the ICRC. We owe it to those who sacrificed their lives on the line of duty, serving people in very dire situations and giving treatment and so on. And we those who are familiar with the way the Security Council resolutions are drafted, it will be very lengthy, yet the objective is clear. We're speaking about creating certain lines of actions, calling the Secretary General to report more frequently, more robustly, giving him a space to do so, and the rapporteurs and so on. And if you'd remember Spain, for instance, when they had women, peace, and security, it took too many years to be consolidated and to become very, very productive in the UN actions and so on. So bear with us a little bit. It's a long way, but yet it's a step on the right direction. We were very happy, very grateful for all the co-sponsors and co-organizers. And we were very happy as well because it will be adopted during the Egyptian presidency in the first week of May. So mark your calendars and by consensus, I hope all the indications would suggest that it will be by consensus, and even looking to have as many co-sponsors as possible from the whole UN family, the wider membership. This is what I wanted to say in brief. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Thank you very much, everyone, for attending this event. Once more, I'd like to thank our co-hosts, the permanent missions of Egypt, Japan, Spain, New Zealand, and Uruguay for co-hosting this event. I want to thank our panelists today, and I want to wish best of luck for the resolution. I think we all look forward to see it.